Every visible thing in the world is put under the charge of an angel. Saint Augustine. In 2002, the British newspaper The Sunday Telegraph reported that the Vatican had banned the veneration of those angels who do not appear in the authorized texts of the Bible. This was an attempt to counter the influence of unnamed New Age groups who were allegedly recruiting new members within the Roman Catholic Church. In future, prayers were only to be directed to the three archangels Michael, Gabriel and Raphael who are mentioned in the Bible. According to the apocryphal and banned Book of Enoch, these were the angelic beings responsible for binding the wicked fallen angels or watchers who had transgressed God's law. The news report said that the early church had excluded the book, attributed to the Old Testament prophet and patriarch Enoch, from the authorized version of the Bible because it described these fallen angels and their activities. Who are the watchers or fallen angels, and why was the early church and the modern Vatican so concerned about them? Genesis 6:1-4 says, "When men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born to them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair, and took them wives of all which they choose." Traditionally, the Beneloa or sons of God numbered several hundred, and they descended to earth on Mount Hermon. Significantly, this was a sacred place to both the Canaanites and the Hebrews who invaded their land. In later times, shrines to the gods Baal, Zeus, Helios and Pan and the goddess Astarte were built on its slopes. These Beneloim or fallen angels were also known as the Watchers, the Grigori and the Irion. In Jewish mythology, the Grigori were originally a superior order of angels who dwelt in the highest heaven with God and resembled human beings in their appearance. 1. The title Watcher simply means one who watches, those who watch, those who are awake or those who do not sleep. These titles reflect the unique relationship between the Watchers and the human race since ancient times. In the esoteric Luciferian tradition, they were a special elite order of angelic beings created by God to be earthly shepherds of the first primitive humans. It was their task to observe and watch over the emerging human species and report back on their progress. However, they were confined by the divine prime directive not to interfere in human evolution. Unfortunately, they decided to ignore God's command and defy his orders and become teachers to the human race, with unfortunate repercussions for both themselves and humanity. Most of the information we have about the Watchers and their activities comes from the apocryphal Book of Enoch. In the Orthodox Bible, the prophet Enoch, from the Hebrew Hanuk or instructor, is a mysterious figure. In Genesis 4:16-23, he is described as the son of Cain, the first murderer, and the first city built by his father is named after him. Further on in Genesis 5:18-19, and several generations later, Enoch is named as the son of Jared, and it is during his lifetime that the Watchers either arrive or incarnate in human bodies. In the apocryphal Book of Jubilee, allegedly dictated by an angel of the Lord to Moses on Mount Sinai when he also received the Ten Commandments, it says that Enoch was the first among men that are born on earth, sick, who learn writing, knowledge and wisdom. It says that Enoch wrote down the signs of heaven, the zodiac signs, according to their months in a book. This was so human beings would know the seasons of the years in relation to the order of the months and their respective stellar and planetary influences. The indication is that Enoch received this information from extraterrestrial angelic sources, that is the Watchers, and therefore he was a cultural exemplar. The fallen angels instruct humanity. 200 of the fallen angels descended from the heavenly realm onto the summit of Mount Hermon, and they were so smitten by the beauty of human women that, using their new material bodies, they had sex with them. This further incurred Yahweh's wrath and, according to the Bible, the consequence of this miscegenation between the fallen ones and mortals led to the creation of half-angelic, half-human offspring, Genesis 6-4. These children were called the Nephilim or Nephilim, and they were the giant race that once inhabited old earth. The fallen angels taught their wives and children a variety of new technological skills, magical knowledge and occult wisdom. This suggests that psychic abilities and magical powers were originally an ancient inheritance from the angelic realm given to early humans. In the Luciferian tradition, this is known in spiritual and metaphorical terms as the witch blood, elven blood or fairy blood that is possessed by witches and wizards. In the Book of Enoch it says that the leader of the fallen angels was called Azazel, and he is often identified with Lucifer, the light bringer, or Lumiel, the light of God. He taught men to forge swords and make shields and breastplates, body armor. Azazel also taught them metallurgy and how to mine from the earth and use different metals. To the women he taught the art of making bracelets, ornaments, rings and necklaces from precious metals and stones. He also showed them how to beautify their eyelids with kohl and the use of cosmetic tricks to attract and seduce the opposite sex. From these practices Enoch says there came much godlessness and men and women committed fornication, were led astray and became corrupt in their ways. This was the basis for the early church condemning the fallen angels for teaching women to make necklaces from pieces of gold and bracelets for their arms. Saint Paul said that women should cover their head in the synagogue, Corinthians 11:5-6. This was because the fallen angels were supposed to be attracted to human females with long flowing hair. The custom of women covering their hair in churches is still found in Roman Catholicism and also in the customs of Islam. The fallen angel Shemiazah, another form of Azazel, is said by Enoch to have taught humans the use of root cuttings and the magical art of enchantment. The fallen angel Armroz taught the resolving, banishing, of enchantments. Barakichel taught astrology. Gokabiel, the knowledge of the constellations, astronomy. Chasakiel, the knowledge of the clouds and the sky, weather lore and divination. Shamsiel, the signs of the sun, the solar mysteries. Sariel, the courses of the moon, the lunar cycles used in horticulture and agriculture and the esoteric lunar mysteries. Benamil instructed humans in the art of writing and reading, and Kashtijan taught the diagnosis and healing of diseases and the science of medicine. It is obvious from these descriptions of the teaching abilities of the Watchers that they were cultural exemplars and the bringers of civilization to the early human race. It is therefore strange that in Orthodox Judeo-Christian religious texts they are misrepresented as evil corruptors of humanity. Some idea of the original exalted status and real nature of the sons of God and the angels of the Lord can be found hidden in the ancient annals of angelic lore. For instance, Gokabiel is described as a great angelic prince who rules over the stars. 2. In the Sibylline Oracles, Erechiel is one of the fallen angels who guides the souls of the dead to judgment in the underworld. Shamsiel, possible originally a Babylonian sun god, was called the Prince of Paradise because he was one of the guardian angels who watched over the gates to Eden. In this role he took Moses to see the heavenly garden and he also watched over the treasures of King David and his son Solomon the Wise. This reference may be to spiritual treasures rather than physical gold and jewels. In the Jewish Zohar he is named as the chief aide-de-camp to the mighty archangel Uriel and bore his standard into battle. Sariel was an angel associated with fertility of the earth and the spring equinox, northern hemisphere, in March. He governed the martial zodiac sign of Aries the Ram and was invoked for protection against the malefic power of the evil eye. Azazel, Lucifer, Lumiel. Azazel, the leader of the Watchers, as mentioned before, was identified with Lucifer or Lumiel. In the Quran it is said that Lucifer Lumiel, Iblis, rebelled against Allah because he was told to bow down and worship the clayborn man of earth Adam and refused. He was forced to fight a battle in heaven with the archangel Michael or Michael and his army of the Lord. As a result Lumiel and his rebel angels were cast out of heaven and fell down to earth. Here Lumiel became the lord of the world and in Christian mythology he was falsely identified with the bogeyman Satan. However, esoterically in the Luciferian tradition, Lumiel or Lumiel is not an evil satanic figure luring humankind into temptation and acts of evil as the church represents him. He is the angel of God, who, rebelled against the static, established cosmic order and set in motion the forces of change and evolution. 3. It is possible that Lumiel may have originated in Canaan-Ishihar, the god of the morning star, Venus. He had a twin called Shalem, who was also symbolized by the planet Venus, but as the evening star. These divine bright and dark twins represented the solar light emerging from the darkness of night at dawn and descending into it at dusk. They were the children of the goddess Asherah, and there is archaeological evidence from the Middle East that the Hebrews adopted her worship when they settled in Canaan and practiced it alongside reverence of the tribal storm god Yahweh. The Old Testament has several references to the continued worship of Asherah as Queen of Heaven by the allegedly monotheistic Hebrews. This took place at shrines in sacred groves on hills where they made offerings of cakes and incense to the goddess. In Canaanite mythology, Shahar, as the lord of the morning star, was cast down from heaven for defying the high god El in the form of a lightning bolt. In that form he fertilized Mother Earth with his divine phallic force. Azazel is represented as a metalsmith and a fire-working sorcerer or magician. He has also been compared to the biblical first smith Tubal-Cain, a descendant of the half-human, half-angelic first murderer Cain. The actual name Azazel has variously been translated as God of Victory, the Strength of God, the Strong God, and even the Goat God. In the apocryphal Apocalypse of Abraham, he is called the Lord of Heathens, suggesting he was originally a pagan god. He has also been identified with the serpent in the Edenic myth that seduced the first woman and mother of all living, Eve. In a Persian text known as the Rum al-Kabab or the Primordial Book, dating from the 8th century CE, the angel Azazel or Azazel is said to have refused to acknowledge the superiority of Adam over the angels. As a result, Allah expelled him and his rebel angels from the heavenly realm to live on earth. More generally, in Islamic lore, Azazel or Azrael is the angel of death and he acts as a guide for the souls of the dead. In Leviticus 16:8-10 and in the Dead Sea Scrolls, a curious Hebrew ritual is recorded that features Azazel as the name for the scapegoat that takes on the communal sins of Israel. It says that the high priest Aaron took two goats from the flock and cast lots, practiced divination, to choose which one would be the scapegoat and sacrificed as a sin offering. The scrolls say that the high priest confessed all the impurities of the children of Israel over the head of the Azazel goat. By this ritually symbolic act, he transferred to the unfortunate animal all their guilt and sins so they could be absolved of them. The goat was then either cast out into the wilderness to die or thrown over a cliff to be dashed to pieces on the rocks below. This ancient and archetypal concept of the scapegoat sacrificed for the sins of the human race and abandoned in the wilderness is a powerful and potent motif that appears several times in biblical myths. It can be seen in the story of Cain, who becomes an exiled wanderer on the earth after being marked by God and banished east of Eden after killing his brother Abel. In one Jewish legend, the wise King Solomon, a powerful magician who could summon and control demons, fell from grace because he whored after foreign gods. He was forced by God to leave Jerusalem and wander in the desert disguised as a beggar. Also, after their exodus from slavery in Egypt, Moses and the Israelites were forced to spend 40 years wandering in the desert before they were allowed to enter the Promised Land, Canaan. In ancient Egyptian mythology, the dark god Set is represented as a divine outcast who dwells in the desert and, after she left Adam, his first wife Lilith or Lilia fled to the wilderness away from human habitation. In the New Testament, Jesus wandered in the wilderness for 40 days and nights. He was not accepted as a teacher in his own town of Nazareth and was rejected as the promised Messiah by his people. When Jesus was crucified, he symbolically took on the role of the sacrificial scapegoat who dies to cleanse the sins of the human race. It is possible that the account of the ritual of the goat god Azazel may have been an autumn equinox or harvest rite of Syrian, Hittite or Canaanite origin adopted by the Hebrews. Originally, a goat would have been selected by means of a divination ritual and then offered to a desert god or demon that had to be placated by the shedding of blood. Eventually, the sacrifice was made to Yahweh as a petition to forgive the sins of his followers. Azazel was popularly believed to have a retinue of hairy he-goat demons known as the Sarum who, like the Watchers, lusted after human women. It cannot be a total coincidence that the church imagined the devil or Satan in the form of a hairy half-human he-goat with a massive erect phallus who had sexual intercourse with his female worshippers at the witch's Sabbath. Shemiyazah is seen by some modern Luciferians as either the emissary of Lumiel or one of his avatars, an incarnated divine being in human form. He not only fell in love with human women, but also with the Babylonian deity Ishtar, the goddess of love and war. She promised to have sex with him if he would in return reveal to her the secret name of God. When Shemiyazah told her, Ishtar used this forbidden knowledge to ascend to the stars and she reigned over the constellation of Pleiades or the Seven Sisters. While the other watchers were rounded up by the archangels and punished by God, Shemyaza voluntarily repented his error and sentenced himself to hang upside down in the constellation of Orion the Hunter, with whom he is sometimes identified in the Luciferian tradition. In the Kabbalistic tradition, Nama, the sister of the biblical first smith Tubal-Cain, seduced Azazel, and she has been associated with Ishtar. 4. A race between gods and men. As we have seen, the end result of the illicit relationships between the Watchers and the Daughters of Men was, according to Judeo-Christian propaganda, the spawning of a monstrous race of warlike, blood-drinking cannibalistic giants called the Nephilim. Genesis 6-4 less dramatically describes them as the mighty men of old, men of renown. At first they were fed manna, ambrosia or the food of the gods, by Yahweh to stop them consuming human flesh, but they rejected it. They slaughtered animals for food instead and then began to hunt down and eat human prey. It has been speculated that this legend is based on the culinary habits of the nomadic desert herdsmen in the Middle East, who were voracious meat-eaters. In the biblical myth of Cain and Abel, the dispute between the two brothers that led to the first murder is over the nature of the offerings made to Yahweh. Abel, a keeper of sheep or nomadic herdsman, offered the firstlings of the flock. And Cain, who was the tiller of the ground or farmer-gardener, offered the fruit of the ground, Genesis 4-2-4. Abel's burnt offerings of animal flesh and blood were pleasing to Yahweh, but he rejected the vegetables, cereal and fruit offered by his brother. On a purely material level, as opposed to a mythic and spiritual metaphor, this story may reflect the struggle for dominance between nomadic herdsmen and the early farmers of the Neolithic Age in the Middle East. The idea of semi-divine heroes was born from the ancient myths of unions between the gods and mortals. The poet and writer Pindar, 518-438 BCE, described the heroes of the past as a race between gods and men. In the Dead Sea Scrolls, the terrible human-eating Nephilim are in fact described as the guardians of arcane knowledge who knew all the mysteries of nature and science. There are also oblique references to the breeding techniques they taught that suggest they instructed early humans in the domestication and rearing of animals. Additional references also hint at experiments that led to the creation of monsters by the interbreeding of animals with different and unrelated species. In modern theosophical occultism, there are legends about the lost continent of Atlantis that claim its scientists bred half-human, half-animal hybrids as a slave race. In our own time, scientists are experimenting with genetic research and animal cloning experiments. It is widely rumored that in China there have recently been abortive attempts to create a new half-human, half-animal hybrid species. These unnatural experiments led to the cataclysmic disaster that destroyed Atlantis. This also relates to the destruction of the Nephilim and the early human race in the biblical flood. Records of such an event can also be found in the mythology of ancient peoples worldwide and especially among the Babylonians in the Middle East. In fact, it is claimed that the story of Noah and the flood in the Old Testament originated in Babylonian and Sumerian myths. 10,000 BC and the end of the Ice Age. It is known that around 10,000 BC there seems to have been a cultural explosion that transformed early humankind. At the end of the last ice age, the first signs of agriculture appeared in the Middle East with a shift from a nomadic hunter-gatherer lifestyle to that of settled farming. This marked the beginning of civilization in this area. As early as 9500 BC, barley, wheat and rye were being cultivated and oats, peas and lentils were being grown by our Neolithic ancestors in what is now modern Kurdistan, between Turkey and Iraq. At the same time, dogs, goats and sheep were also domesticated. Within 1,000 years, copper and lead smelting was being practiced in Anatolia, modern Turkey, and archaeologists believe this process was first discovered in Kurdistan, along with weaving and pottery making. The ancient Kurdish culture was also the first to develop a script and was one of the earliest literate societies in the Middle East. The Kurds claim to be the descendants of the children of the jinn, spirits, the offspring of a mating between the jinns and mortal women. In some parts of Kurdistan, especially among the sect of Yazidis, who worship the peacock angel, Azazel, the leader of the fallen angels, can be found tall, fair-haired people with blue eyes. Although anthropologists believe they may be of ancient European ancestry, popular folk belief among the Kurds says they are descendants of the children of the jinn, who in ancient times brought civilization to early humankind. In general, the ancient Middle East was known as the cradle of civilization, with the earliest city-states being founded in the Mesopotamian area, modern Iraq and Iran. The early indigenous people of the region, the Sumerians and Akkadians, developed the first written language, studied astronomy and created libraries. The Babylonians and Assyrians followed them, and in the mythology of all these races are stories of how the gods descended to earth and taught them the arts of civilization. In the Book of Enoch it says that when Yahweh saw the lawlessness, chaos, corruption and sexual immorality that had been caused by the interaction of the Watchers and humans, he decided to intervene through the agency of the archangels Michael, Raphael, Gabriel, and Uriel. He commanded Raphael to bind Azazel hand and foot like a sacrificial goat and cast him into a deep ravine in the desert. Gabriel was sent on a divine mission to destroy the bastards and reprobates and the children of the Watchers amongst men. 5. The archangel Michael, the commander of the army of God, was sent to arrest Shemaiah and bind him under the earth until judgment day. As we have seen, the fallen angel repented his sins and sentenced himself to cosmic exile among the stars. The Book of Jubilee says that the archangels bound the Watchers in the depths of the earth, and in Judaic lore they are imprisoned in a mysterious second heaven. However, it is also said that some of these mighty warriors have a special place reserved for them in Sheol, the Jewish underworld. There they are said to lie in state with shield and spear intact. Christian O'Brien has suggested 6. There is a connection between the biblical Watchers and the semi-divine, semi-mythical to Athitadinan, children of the goddess Dana. This race of ancient magicians descended to earth on the sacred hill of Dara in prehistoric Ireland. With the coming of Christianity, the Tuatha-de-Danann was banished into the hollow hills and became the She, or Shining Ones, the elves and fairies of Irish folklore. There has always been a strong belief among the peasantry in Ireland that the good people or fairies were originally the fallen angels who sided with Lucifer in the Battle of Heaven. In this article we have constantly referred to the Watchers as angelic beings with a spiritual form who incarnated in physical bodies to have sexual relations with mortal women. In recent years a considerable amount of speculative literature has been published suggesting that instead they were of earthly origin. Popular best-selling authors such as Andrew Collins, Seven Graham Hancock and Ian Lawson have claimed that the biblical myth of the Watchers represents memories of a primeval elder race of superhumans belonging to a lost civilization who taught their technology to more primitive people. Lawson has claimed that this unknown ancient race may have been spiritually advanced souls who incarnated to help early humankind and were corrupted by them in the process. Collins has also recently launched a new project to investigate the magical aspects of the legend. Symbolism of the myth of the fallen angels. What is the esoteric significance behind the myth of the fallen angels, the expulsion of Lucifer from heaven and the fall of man as represented by the Garden of Eden saga? In the Bible, Lucifer is often depicted in the reptilian form of a dragon or serpent, and in the West this creature is symbolic of evil and the powers of chaos. Babylonian, Hittite, Canaanite, Iranian, Egyptian, Greek and Norse myths all describe in various forms a struggle between a supreme father god, representing cosmic order and harmony, and a younger rebellious god who challenges and tries to overthrow divine authority. Although these conflicts usually take place in a pre-human epoch, they are also sometimes depicted as occurring in world history and are often connected with the creation and early development of the human species and the rise of ancient civilizations. Symbolically, Lucifer or Lumiel is known as the Lord of Light, as he is the firstborn of creation. He represents the active cosmic energy of the universe and has been identified with fire, light, phallic power, independent thought, consciousness, progress, liberty and independence. The founder of the modern Theosophical Society, Madame Helena Blavatsky, described the Lightbringer as the spirit of intellectual enlightenment and the freedom of thought, without whose influence humanity would be no better than animals. 8. In the Bible, Lucifer, or Satan as he is mistakenly called, is often depicted in reptilian form as either a dragon or a serpent. In Western mythologies, this creature is commonly misrepresented as a symbol of the powers of darkness, chaos and evil. In contrast, in Eastern mythology the dragon is a good omen representing fertility and good fortune. Lumiel Lucifer is often identified with the serpent in the Edenic myth described in Genesis. In the Luciferian tradition, the biblical serpent is regarded as the personification of knowledge, wisdom and enlightenment who liberated the first humans from the spiritual ignorance imposed on them by Yahweh. The serpent is seen as the symbol of an outside liberating force that quite literally opened the eyes of Adam and Eve to the reality of the created universe and the wonders of the material world. The snake, serpent or dragon is an ancient mythical and archetypal image of the solar phallic power or life force that is associated with Lucifer and the explosion of light following the divine celestial event that created the universe, known by modern scientists as the Big Bang. When the first man and woman ate the forbidden fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in the astral or heavenly garden, they became consciously aware. Their first realization was that their physical cloaks of flesh were naked. They rushed to cover their genitals as they had become aware of the so-called serpent power or kundalini that can be raised by sexual intercourse and non-reproductive sex acts. They also ate from the tree of life, which initiated the cycle of birth, life, death and rebirth and of human souls incarnating in physical form. Interestingly, the anthropologist and shamanic teacher Dr. Michael Harner has described an experience he had in the jungle of the Peruvian Amazon after partaking of the hallucinogenic vine ayahuasca. He had a vision of a dragon proud ship with a crew of bird-headed humans. He then encountered an ancient race of reptilian entities that he believes exist within each human being in the brain stem at the base of the skull and the top of the spinal column. These reptilian life forms told Dr. Harner they had arrived on Earth eons ago from the stars. Allegedly, they created life here so they had somewhere to hide and were the true masters of the planet. The anthropologist mentioned this to an old Indian shaman and he said he knew about these entities and called them the masters of the outer darkness. 9. The myth of the Watchers, the fall of Lucifer and the fall of man all represent the primeval dreamtime or golden age of cosmic and earthy harmony and primal innocence that may have existed on the material plane or on some kind of astral or pre-material plane. It is the symbolic or actual physical destruction of this heavenly or earthly paradise, where humans and animals live together and communicated by a universal language, which is reflected in such myths and legends. In shamanic terms, it is known as the Great Separation when humans no longer knew or understood the language of the animals. It was also a time when humans began to communicate together in different languages, and this is represented by the biblical story of the Tower of Babel. The myth of the Golden Age or Paradise on Earth is closely linked with the fall of Lucifer from heaven and the diminishing of his former status as the firstborn of creation to become the Lord of the world. On a symbolic and metaphorical level, as well as a physical one, it is also connected to the separation of humans from nature and their natural environment that is manifesting in our modern times. It was the deliberate intervention of Lucifer and the fallen angels in human evolution, rather than any defiance of cosmic authority, which ultimately led to their fall from heavenly grace. The Watchers' only crime was that they wanted to help the progress of their human flock. However, the refusal of Lucifer rightly to recognize the creation of human beings means that the fall from heavenly grace was inevitable. In the Luciferian tradition, Lumiel is promised redemption and the restoration of his former status in the cosmic plan. This can only come to pass when the human race spiritually evolves. So it is to the benefit of Lumiel and his teaching angels to help us achieve that end. The relationship between humanity and the leader of the fallen ones is therefore very much a symbiotic one, as they need each other.